by as we unlock more secrets behind Britain's longest running and best loved antiques show. Welcome to Priceless Antiques Roadshow. Hello again. In this episode, we reveal the saucy side to the Antiques Roadshow with our very own ladies' man, Eric Knowles.
I don't know why it is that all the sort of naked women that appear in this programme gravitate towards me.
With the inside story of the Antiques Roadshow as we follow our experts on a day in the life of the programme.
And these lovely scrolling leaves as well. This is such a lovely example.
What I do need to know is your name, Sean Connery.
No, he's joking.
And David Batty reveals how his life changed because of a bird.
Almost overnight, I suddenly thought, I can understand ceramics.
Just occasionally, working on the Antiques Roadshow can feel a bit like being in a carry-on film. You might think that items of a more risque nature are a modern phenomenon. That's not the case at all.
On a very wet day, how nice to see a dirty picture.
Hide your eyes, girls. Hide your eyes.
I thought they'd make you blush before.
I'm beyond blushing.
Are you?
I've seen it all.
It's a good job we haven't got one of the older experts here, because I think those chaps would be getting sort of all hot under the collar and so on.
Now, I don't know why it is that all the sort of naked women that appear in this programme gravitate towards me.
Well, when it comes to dealing with items that you might be described as risque.
Well, that's right.
To be frank with you, because I've worked in this business for, you know, most of my life, when I see a nude figure, I just see a piece of sculpture.
We obviously share the same taste in women, leggy and preferably naked.
But I do seem to gravitate towards lean, leggy, naked ladies. And it's just part of the job.
I like this girl over here.
When slightly naughty things come in, I'm usually not allowed to look at them.
Eric Knowles likes this when he sees them. We always said lady nudes to him.
He can take it, you know, nude ladies or semi-nude figures.
Well, they specially said it should come to you.
Oh, did they?
Definitely.
I've got a reputation on this programme.
Definitely.
What can I say?
I'm not allowed to see those, but I'd love to see them. I think it's wonderful when you do. They can be quite exciting.
I never expected to see such a bit of amusing frivolity in Sunderland. Is it a family position?
Yes, from the great-grandmothers.
Great-grandmothers?
I can't imagine it's a ladies' thing. It's even naughtier on the backside. What is he doing? A man is smacking the lady's bottom with a pair of a... Dare one say knickers on a towel? It's very, very naughty, isn't it?
But I was a bit younger then, I could take it in, I suppose, more. But if it was now, oh, Lord, I get it very embarrassed, I think.
Why, when and how did you get hold of a chastity belt?
The guy who came in with a chastity belt, I mean, he was wonderful. He was, in fact, a collector of agricultural bits, I seem to remember, and he bought this because it was patently blacksmith made.
You've got the business end, if you like,
correct.
There.
Correct.
And then this would slot round your waist, and
correct.
Presumably there'd be a hefty padlock. Have you got any daughters at home?
Yes, but she got married 2 years ago.
We had a real joke about the fact that, you know, it hadn't got its padlock, and that how he didn't need it anymore now that his daughter was married, although it had been very useful during her teenage years. Every home needs one.
Exactly. And we've had some fun with it at quizzes and the village pub, etc.
And do people know what it is immediately?
No, far from it.
But I believe the history goes back to the Crusaders, when the knights set off for the Holy Wars and locked up all their valuables, including their wives.
I was very lucky to be invited to be a reporter
on the Swedish Antiques Roadshow to watch them making their own show.
Edda from Mika.
Aye. Were you fair at?
Well, it's well known that the Scandinavians are far more relaxed about sex than the Brits. And that came over when the presenter tried to embarrass me with this little stack of Japanese porcelain.
We've got an interesting box here, which is just about to be recorded. I have to say, that would never get on BBC television before 9 o'clock.
Is that still so?
It is.
Because 10 years ago, when we were working together, they were a little bit worried about these things, but I thought that you had changed your mind.
We haven't. And the problem is that we have many young people, like my daughters, watching it, and they will say, "Mummy, Daddy," they will freeze frame, "What's he doing?" And it's a bit difficult.
Why haven't you told your kids? All about, you know, flowers and bees.
I leave that to David Attenborough in the wildlife programme.
Well, now and then you do come across items and you think, I wonder if we can actually use this. Is this going to be in the best possible taste? And I did debate long and hard about the VD vibrator. The VD vibrator for mechanical massage. And uses to the healthy, facial massage, hair, health, athletes and general tonic. And it's used to uses to the sick, rheumatism, constipation. That's got me mind boggling. Quick burst on your VD vibrator and you're right as rain. I've yet to have a letter from anybody who watched that particular programme saying, oh no, they really work.
Perhaps we should consider a late night edition of the Antiques Roadshow. Now for passions of a different kind, as we welcome another tip for a canny future investment. Clive Farahar says, forget gold, there's money to be made in books.
Well, people often ask me about collecting books. What should they collect? And the answer is these things, which are pop-up books from the 20th and 21st century. Some are incredibly boring and you wouldn't want them, but these are absolutely incredible. And this one, Commander Nova's pop-up alien space station, I think is absolutely tremendous. Look at this. Now, who could say no to that? I mean, that is just stunning, don't you think? And it's not the only one in the book, but the book is just full of all sorts of things that children could do. Now, you give a book to a child and they will play with it. They will open it, they will possibly bend it. And these books are very vulnerable. So if you're an adult and you have a juvenile turn of mind, you could probably handle these rather better. The value that they might have in the future, I could be entirely wrong. People may decide that pop-up books are just not fun. I think they're enormous fun. And as I say, the bookmaker's art is all here, really. And you can buy these now for a few pounds, £2, £3, £5, for a particularly good one. And that's fine. It's the price of a pint. And I think that they're worth, possibly in 20, 30 years' time, I should think they'll be worth considerably more than that. At least that's what I'm banking on.
I've got one of those, so I'm going to hang on to it. It's not just developing an expert eye that makes the Antiques Roadshow specialist so successful. They need years of experience in their field, the ability to tell a great story, and on a typical Antiques Roadshow, enough energy to take them through a long and tiring day. We follow two of our team from dawn to dusk at a recent show to see how they rise to the challenge.
When I wake up in the morning, love, and the sunlight hurts my eyes.
I usually get up really, really early because I need that time to sort of get prepared for all the people coming on the day, because you never know what's going to happen. I'm really looking forward to the day. I think it's going to be busy. I don't think it's going to be mega busy, but I think we'll have about 2,000 people, which is quite enough for 20 experts. And miscellaneous, you simply never know what you're going to see.
In the morning, you know it's going to be all right.
Just not in the mood for breakfast. I grab a juice, a coffee and a banana and basically jump in the car. I've been doing the roadshow now for a couple of years, and I suppose you I suppose you do feel a bit like the new boy, but the great thing is it's such a good team of people and everyone sort of helps each other out, and it's a real sort of, it's great actually because you meet up with people you haven't seen for a couple of months and then it's like you'd sort of picked up where you left off. It's great. It is great fun. Now listen, I've really got to get going, so I'll see you there.
The crowds are already gathering outside Abbotsford, the beautiful castle built for Sir Walter Scott. Inside, the production crew and specialists make their last preparations before the gates open. Evaluations have started, and all the experts are searching for the perfect object to show to the cameras. Expert Judith Miller thinks she's spotted something for Bunny.
There's a bird in the garden.
Listen.
Isn't that lovely?
That is fantastic.
Isn't that fantastic?
Does he stop? Lost his colour a bit.
Yes, well, the lady says she doesn't remember him having colour at all, but he definitely has lost his colour.
Oh, yes. Oh!
I love the way he goes up.
I'd love to do it.
Oh,
yes.
Please. Absolutely. Really? Happy to do it. Of course. I haven't said anything to you about it at all.
Can't stop him.
With over 2,000 visitors, John Foster has kept busy valuing objects, hoping to find a piece that might make the programme.
In this sort of condition, it's really not going to be worth a great deal. I mean, to a collector, it's maybe £10-20, but condition is everything with these, and being a facsimile or a reproduction copy, there's not a huge amount of demand for it.
Bunny goes over for a chat with the owners of the bird.
Morning. I don't want to tell you anything because I'd love to film it, but I need to know from you whether you've had it a long time and that you didn't buy it yesterday, otherwise it doesn't make good filming.
It's actually in my family. I inherited it through the family, and I honestly don't know where it came from originally.
Right, what I do need to know is your name. So what I then do is I get a kind person to take you to the waiting room where they will come and see you, and then they'll clock you in for filming if the producer allows me to do it.
Connery,
so what time are we? Sean Connery.
No, he's joking.
Right.
Just seen a really lovely salon carved hardwood box, which basically you fill out a record request form, hand it over, put it in a little box. The producer then will decide, they'll go meet the owner, decide whether they like the object. You've got to make it sound interesting to the producer, and then you've got, hopefully, a much higher chance of it getting filmed.
Hello, I'm Simon. I'm one of the producers on the show. Nice to see you. What have you brought in today?
I'd have said this is probably dating to the 20s, 1920s. Mm-hmm. And it's ironic that there we have an elephant with an ivory teething ring. Yes, yes. And they're very collectible teething rings.
Sorry to interrupt. Bunny, quick word. The automata, the bird.
Yes.
We have filmed a number of them in this series.
Oh, this series.
That's fine. What I like that's different about this is that they want to ask you about restoration on it, because actually it is in quite a poor condition. Mm-hmm. So that feels like something we could take a different angle on.
Okay.
There's always a bit of light relief at glass expert Andy McConnell's table.
Into the punch, you then put your thumb over the top of it. The punch then is sealed by a vacuum. You lift it over to the glass, release your thumb, and there is your glass of punch, don't you know? Oh, yes!
John's box gets the producer's seal of approval.
We'll fill out an appointment time for you so that you know what time we'll be recording it, and enjoy that conversation.
Okay.
Thank you.
While Bunny's bird gets the thumbs up, the director gives John a few tips before cameras roll.
When you're talking about the box, try not to hold on to it.
Okay.
There's a few ways.
I'm going to go jack it off.
Jack it off.
This is sort of my cup of tea. This sort of thing. Now, I'm mad about boxes. I mean, tell me why you like it.
Well, I like boxes too. I've got quite a few.
It's unusual because a lot of people don't like, you know, dark carved wood. Mm. And these lovely scrolling leaves as well.
The filming day is in full swing, and now it's Bunny's time for action.
All right. Everybody happy? When are you ready, Bunny?
Yeah. Well, all I can say is for a singing bird, really does look a bit bedraggled. These uprights are all bent. Can I ask you what you've been doing with it?
And all John's hard work has paid off as he gets the go-ahead for another recording.
I'm about to film on main unit, which has got three cameras on you rather than one. So it is a bit more nerve-wracking, but yeah, it's still been fun.
Fifty items have been filmed today, with over 30 due to make the final cut.
I've done one recording, which I hope won't be cut, you never know. And I've got two more recordings to go. It's been a really good day, the most lovely surroundings. We've got a little bit of breeze. It has been incredibly hot.
I've had a really good day actually today. There's been some really lovely things brought to the tables. I've done three recordings, which is great. I mean, it's winding down a bit now, which is nice actually, because you can then spend a bit more time chatting to people and just finding out a bit more of the history, because I mean, that's what we love. But no, I've really enjoyed it today actually. It's been one of my favourites.
Despite the heat, the team of experts stay on site until every item has been valued. And I can tell you, it was sweltering that day at Melrose. And those experts worked like Trojans, valuing thousands of objects late into the evening. And it's not just the rare or valuable that tickles our interest. Now and again, something altogether different comes along, which gives us all pause for thought, as former presenter Hugh Scully recalls.
We were at Athelhampton, and a man came in with a contraption that certainly was not a work of art.
We came one afternoon to have a look round Athelhampton, and they had certain items they were getting rid of. They were clearing things they didn't want, and this man trap was one of them.
Well, this thing, which I did regard certainly as one of the most awful things I'd ever seen on the show, was essentially a man trap, and it was used on estates around England not to catch any animals. It was specifically designed to catch poachers, and poachers, of course, were numerous in the England of the 17th and 18th centuries.
It would be set in the bracken,
yes,
and then a poacher would stand on the check plate and spring the jaws.
I don't think the owner really ever thought about exactly how awful the thing was. He was so enthusiastic about the sheer mechanics of it that he didn't stop to think about how gruesome the object itself was.
It wants the lightest of pressures.
And that's not the only uncomfortable item we've seen on the roadshow.
We always see Scrimshaw. Scrimshaw is well known on the roadshow. Usually it's made by sailors in the 19th century from tusks and teeth, from maritime creatures, and usually there is a maritime connection. There are whaling scenes.
The only thing I know about it is that a friend of ours about 30 years ago was using it as a doorstop.
This was something very different. It was a long tusk, and it was carved in relief with, I think, what can I only call sort of rather macabre cannibal scenes.
Here we've got a complete sort of traditional view of cannibal life.
That's right, yes.
You know, first select your victim, cut the head off, then you cut him into smaller pieces, there's the legs.
It was like a cartoon scene of how we used to imagine cannibals. You know, go back to 1920s seaside postcards, and there are cannibals cooking missionaries in pots. Well, this was telling the same story in a very, very direct way.
It's clearly 19th century, you know, it belongs to that period. Whether it was a rather bizarre tourist piece, which I suspect, we'll never know.
Yes.
But certainly it's the Africans, in a sense, sending themselves up. You know, this is what the Europeans think we do, so we'll do it.
Yes.
Some of our most gruesome objects have been quite close to the bone.
I shall never forget a roadshow where this woman brought in an extraordinary collection of skulls. I really should have resisted the temptation to say, alas, poor Yorick, but this is one of the weirdest things that's turned up at the roadshow, as far as I can remember. Tell me, how on earth did it start?
I was about 8 years old, and I fell down a hole by a convent.
Right.
And while I was in the hole, I found a mouse skull, and I just thought it was amazing, fascinating. So,
when people first find out I collect skulls, they usually take a step back, because they find it quite a gruesome hobby. They don't find it fascinating like I do.
So, you started with a little mouse.
Yes.
It got bigger and bigger and bigger.
It did.
I think her cat used to bring in birds
And she used to chop their heads off. Well, you know, once they were dead, I hasten to add. And she'd bury the heads. She didn't bother to boil them or whatever you're supposed to do.
Just tell me, what do you do for a living?
I went on to be a veterinary nurse. I retired to have children, but I'm actually just getting back into it again.
Fantastic. So have you got any former patients here?
Sadly, yes. I do have the tortoise. Was a patient.
To our sensibilities, if you're an urban type, we don't find dead animals lying around the streets of London, as it were. But out in the country, there are masses and masses of dead animals all the time. Anyway, skulls in art are a very common feature. We're constantly reminded of our own mortality.
I find them quite beautiful as well. They're quite good to draw. There's lots of different lines on there. They catch the shadows.
And, you know, inevitably I've got to ask who he is.
That's from the Great Plague mass burial grave. Some workmen were digging it up and gave it to a school friend who then kindly passed it on to me.
Very good.
It was an extraordinary collection. And she was perfectly, on the face of it, perfectly, you know, like you and I.
The latest skull I found is this one, which is a hedgehog skull. A friend of mine found it dead in her garden and shoved it under a hedge. And when she mentioned this, I said, oh, well, when it's rotted, I'll have that. Thank you very much.
I do like a woman who tells it like it is. Now, like you, I know David Batty is one of the Antiques Roadshow's long-serving experts. But you know what first ignited his passion for ceramics? He's about to share it with you. In fact, he's shared it with us a number of times. But it's a great story.
I'm delighted to see these here. These were the first love I ever had in the ceramic field. Two vases made by the Martin brothers.
I joined one of the major auction houses as a porter in the 60s, mid-60s. And I hated it. I couldn't stand ceramics. Why would anybody spend £10 on a boring dinner plate? You know, to me, it didn't make any sense at all. And then one of these came in. Yeah.
I thought, that's fantastic. Having been at art school, you know, there was that kind of feeling.
Such fun the man who made this has had. Moulding the clay, sculpting it, yes. And then glazing it and firing it. And really, almost overnight, I suddenly thought, I can understand ceramics. And of course, I've been hooked ever since. But this was what set it off.
Really?
He was made by a man called Robert Wallace Martin, who was the elder brother of 8 children, 4 of whom worked in the Martin brothers' pottery.
Loath to use the word unique. In our world, if you use the word unique about something, within 3 weeks, 14 others have turned up. But they really were. They were the first sort of collective studio potters who were driven not by money, which they never made, but by a love of potting.
The firm Robert Wallace Martin founded with his brothers was founded in 1873. He took with him his brother Charles, who ran the shop, Edwin, who engraved the designs, and Walter Fraser Martin, and he was the one who threw the pots.
They worked in London and Southall, and they had a kiln which they fired in some occasions once a year. So out of that kiln had to come enough good pots to support 4 families, because there were 4 brothers.
And they used to go wrong, and the firings were always going wrong. They would, in 1 year, they got 1 vase out of an entire year's production.
Oh, dear,
and they got £25 for that, and that was all they got for an entire year's work. They spent their entire lives fighting one another and threatening to break up and go work on their own. They were all different religions. The story of them is just so fantastic.
This would have made its way up to the City of London, where they had their shop. And that was run by Charles. Charles was mad. And any good bit which arrived off the boat,
yeah,
he stuck under the floorboards.
Oh, right, squirreled away.
Squirreled away, all the good bits. Mm. And if you wanted to buy something, you look through the window, you saw all this stuff and so I thought, I'd not buy one of those. He wouldn't let you in. Right. And if you got in, he wouldn't sell you anything. So they never, even when there was a potential to make money, they didn't. Then the shop caught fire. The fireman rushed in and chopped all the wooden shelves down, so all the stock was ruined. Oh. And then under the floor, they found all the good birds, the good vases, all squirreled away by Charles, who promptly went barking mad and ended up in a mental home. Oh. It's a brilliant story.
It is, isn't it?
I could go on a lot longer.
And I would love to own a Martin Brothers bird. If only because my wife says that I look like a Martin Brothers owl.
I would happily put a quote of £20,000 to £30,000.
Oh, we?
Unfortunately, I don't have that kind of money.
I always thought he was lucky. It's got even better now.
I'm very jealous. Thank you very much.
So there you have it. The potters who made batty potty for pots. Now, among the many items we feature on the roadshow, there are often heavy pieces of furniture or large paintings. Have you ever wondered how the owners managed to bring them along on the day? Well, the answer is we offer to transport some things that are too big to handle. But some owners prefer to make their own plans, as John Bly recalls.
Mostly, the surprises come when people actually do bring things in themselves. And when you see the opening shot of the little car with a suit of armour in the back, I mean, this is quite true. This is what people do.
So you just brought this in there? I mean, on a van or something?
I just put it on a van. Not moving. That's moving. Yes.
You could move in it, couldn't you, really? But to have brought this thing in, I mean, it was huge and heavy and wonderful. I mean, it must have come out of a tremendously big house. I mean, a massive castle.
Lying in a shed for about 15 years, on and off.
Lying in a shed for 15 years. Well, all the patina's gone, all the colour's gone. Look at the top, you've been stripping paint on here.
I mean, as soon as he said I've got it in the garage, it made sense, because he wouldn't have had it in that state in his house.
I was painting a dairy for a farm, and he just says, take that away.
I just gave it to you.
If someone says to you, take this away, I don't like it, you immediately dismiss it as being something they want to get rid of, so you'll put it in your garage.
You know, we're laughing at it, but, I mean, it's an amazing piece of furniture. You haven't got the top part, have you?
No, no. I know where it's lying.
No?
I know where it's lying.
You don't? Really?
No.
Well, get it. I mean it. Because if you've got the top to that, it changes it from half a nice piece of furniture into an important thing.
But he thought it was interesting enough to put it in the back of his van and send along. And, of course, it was wonderful. I mean, it's a marvellous thing.
Polish the top is easy. A little wax on there would look really good and would start to look like what it's really worth, which is probably in the region of £3,000 or £4,000.
Of course.
And with the top, up goes the price. Really, I mean it.
Stripping paint, mixing paint on the top of it. And, you know, it only needed a little gentle, loving care to bring it back. And I'd love to know whether he did or not. It was very funny.
And there's a lesson for all of us. Check what's hiding in the shed. That's all from us today. But join us for the next Priceless Antiques Roadshow. Bye-bye.
The Age of Worship is the stage that David Dimbleby has reached in his new series on British art. That's what's next tonight here on BBC Two.